Well, good morning, church. We had the front row up here doing a countdown to worship, and then it was reminded to him that the last 3 seconds, you have to be really quiet, and you fade out. So good morning, church. As you can see, I'm not alone up here. I have one of our faithful monkeys who has survived VBS through this week, and is also one of the last remaining monkeys because some of our youth volunteers were very, very excited to take some of these home with them. So you have to excuse me holding on to this monkey this morning. I thought duct tape on my shoulder would work out really well, but alas, the monkey decides that it wants to maybe go a little bit flying. Well, good morning, church. I am Charlotte Crofton. I am a pastoral resident here at Dunwoody, and I am so excited and so thrilled to welcome you all into worship this morning, and I think the monkey's kind of happy too. Is he waving? I don't know. Is he waving? I don't know. Part of ministry is being happy to be a little bit foolish and a little bit childlike. So like I said, I'm Charlotte. I'm happy you all are here. We have donuts in the back, and as you walked in this morning, I hope you received a bulletin, because on the back of that bulletin, there are some announcements, and as well as some concerns and some sympathies that we lift up in this congregation. But also, in this bottom corner, you can see with the monkey foot, there is a QR code. If you all could please scan that QR code and sign in to let us know you are here, because we would love to know that you are here. Another announcement is that there is Spark today for our pre-K through third graders, but they are not leaving at their normal time this morning because, as you can see in the worship outline, there's a VBS medley, and they're going to be singing to us this morning, and they will leave after they do that. So kiddos, if you can hear me, you don't leave after the prayer today, all right? And then there's one final announcement to make, is that this afternoon at 4 p.m., we have our patriotic concert. Our choir is going to put on a patriotic concert, and I've been assured that it's going to be phenomenal, and I believe them, because music here is always phenomenal. So at this point, I ask you all to stand, greet your neighbor. Maybe it means extending a hand. Maybe it means extending an elbow. Who knows? Maybe it means extending a foot. Let us set our sight on Zion, God's holy hill, and let's delight as we worship and gather to worship God this morning. Would you all please stand and worship?
Sing holy, holy. Blessed Trinity.
sky and sea. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God in three persons, blessed
Amen. Let's sing It's Fallen from the Clouds. It's fallen from the clouds, a strange and lovely sound. I hear it in the thunder and rain, and it's ringing in the skies like cannons in the night. The music of the universe plays. You are holy, and we're singing, you are holy, you're great and mighty. The stars declare who you are. I'm so unworthy, but still you love me. Forever my heart will sing of how great you are. Beautiful and free. Oh, beautiful and free. The song of galaxies is reaching far beyond the Milky Way. So let's join in with the sound. Come on, let's sing it out as the music of the universe plays. We're singing, you are holy, you're great and mighty. The moon and the stars declare who you are. And I'm so unworthy, but still you love me. Forever my heart will sing of you. And all glory, honor, power is yours. Amen. All glory, honor, power is yours. Amen. All glory, honor, power is yours. Forever, amen. We're singing, you are holy, you're great and mighty. The moon and the stars declare who you are. And I'm so unworthy, still you love me. Forever my heart will sing of you. Stars declare who you are. Not so unworthy, still you love me. Forever my heart will sing of how great you are. How great you are, oh God.
Please pray with me. Oh, Almighty God, Today we gather together as a witness to the work that you are doing in our lives. But God, when we feel as though the world is against us, may we be reminded of your love, of your grace working in our midst. So Lord, on this day, may we raise our voices together to you. May you be with us, and may we remember that we are filled with this, with the Holy Spirit. On this day, Lord, we lift up Sharon and Carrie Ward on the recent passing of Sharon's mother. And Lord, we hold those who are struggling with substance abuse, mental illness, massive forms of loss and grief. Caring God, may we find comfort in you. And we confess that we may have not always spoken out in boldness, that we have been short with one another, that we have not always extended love. We confess that we have not always laid our possessions before you, and that we have lost sight of what it means to be a child of God. But magnificent God, may we be emboldened. May we be equipped. May we step into the world in the strength of your Spirit. And may it be that we continue to search for everlasting light when we feel as though there are those who are gathered against us. And may we carry with us the light that illuminates all darkness. So stir our hearts, God. Move us to action. And with this meditation upon our hearts, may we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Good morning. It's great to be here and to share with you this morning. In my honors, I'm just loud. Can you hear me? All right. Excellent. Excellent. I always loved Vacation Bible School as a kid, even though I didn't like crafts, because I loved the music, and especially the music where you could learn things with motions, and that would help me to remember the songs as I got to enjoy the motions. I am grateful for the leaders who have helped put Vacation Bible School and God Squad together this week. I want to say a special word of thanks to Chris Mixer. Chris was our director of missions, and he led God Squad for the last several years. And his wife has gotten a new job in Huntsville, Alabama, and he is following her over there and taking a job with Habitat. Our own Sean Penn. Sean, are you here somewhere? Sean's in the back somewhere. And he is going to be our interim director of missions as we figure those things out and get ready for food stock and the holiday festival. So maybe if you're being called to lead and work in missions, we would be glad to have your help, especially during this interim time. But I'm so grateful for all those who allowed the children in our community and in this church to see the face of Jesus in them by leading them and telling them stories about creation, about Moses and the burning bush, about a paralytic man being lowered down through a roof and Jesus offering healing, and the stories of the lost coin, the lost sheep, and the lost son. And as they heard those stories, I hope that those stories of Jesus continue to echo in their hearts and minds. I'd like to invite Tamron Freund, who is the leader of our kids ministry, to come forward. She and her team have done an amazing job. Anybody here for Bible school? Yeah. All right, let's say a word of thank you to Miss Tamron and her team.
Good morning, y'all. Every year I get up here and I say, it was a great week of VBS and God Squad. And I have to get up here and say, it was a really great week of VBS and God Squad. So if you don't know, the shirts you see today, we had approximately 370 kids who registered and came and visited us this week. To put that in perspective, we only have 170 kids on our roster, and not all of them were here. So if we are trying to say that Dunwoody Methodist needs to be a place that opens up and welcomes everybody, we achieved it this week. But the energy was palpable. And the thing that, before I go too far, that comes to our leaders who lead before the week. So we have a lot of people here in the blue shirts, but we had a specific handful that start planning sometimes in January, and depending on what their area is, maybe about June 15th. It just depends on how gung-ho they are to get started. But if you don't know, we had Becca Leinberger as our VBS coordinator this year. And if you volunteered, you heard from Amanda Jordan, who was our volunteer coordinator, or Jennifer Cheek, who was the volunteer coordinator for God Squad. And just so you hear the other areas, we had Science Snack, all of those. Those were Rachel Chinficki, Allison Gimo, Mark Freund, Eric Cheek, Brian Jordan, Jessica Levinella, Julia Leach, Ashley Coron. And some of those do have kids in the program and some don't. So if you are ever interested in being one of those people who helps sort of outside of just the week, we would really appreciate it. But that week we had over 200 people registered to volunteer here. And that's where the energy comes from. So we had 200 volunteers, including youth. 43 of those youth volunteered every day. They were here 4 days. So, agreed. If you volunteered this week, would you please stand, whether you're in your shirt or not? I know who you are. So, these are some of the volunteers for the week.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. What makes VBS special is people like Aaron Griffin, our youth coordinator, who is here helping pull kids who are no longer in VBS in one direction together, all to serve children who may or may not be hearing the word of God at home. It's our volunteers who come out en masse, whether they are in the trenches with kids now, or they are grandparents, or they're just empty nesters who had a couple of days and came. And that sense of community is what makes VBS so special every year. And that is what Dunwoody United Methodist is known for. It's what makes us special. It's what makes it so much fun to be here. And so from the kids team to all of you, we want to say thank you. And we want to invite those awesome kids who are here today to share some of that energy through our music. So if you can come on up, if you're here and you remember even one word of a VBS song, hey, cheat sheet, we're going to play the music, so come on up. I see you in your shirts. You can come up right here with Miss Nicole. Come on up here. You get a chance to look into this bright light that I have been looking into, and I will turn it over to Miss Nicole to lead you in song.
All right, come on up, everybody. I see some more out there. We'll fit up. We're going to fill this little stage up, Pastor Phil. Come on up.
And just because you don't come up front doesn't mean I'm not going to ask you to do the motions.
Well, yeah. I think all of our helpers need to also be doing the motions. We've all done it a million times. Okay. All right. Well, what does Miss Marianella say? One, a two, a one, two, hit it.
Discovery on Adventure Island.
Y'all stay up there. Nicole, we need to make sure they know the motions. Don't you think we need to get them up and see if they can know the motions? So arise.
Arise.
Okay, can you teach them the motions to this one?
Arise.
Rise, shine. For your light has come.
Arise. Shine. For your light has come. For the glory of the Lord has shone.
Amen. Amen. And now we invite the children who want to go with Miss Tamron to our Spark program that happens during this sermon. They're welcome to come back and sit with Mom and Dad head back to have a lesson that goes with the sermon, but back in the room across the hall. We promise to bring your children back or for you to go get them. Isn't it amazing how a song can make you feel like you're a part of something? When I go to Truist Park and I cheer on my second favorite team, the Braves, you get there and things begin and they start singing and you stand up and you place your hand over your heart for the Star Spangled Banner and you realize that you are a part of something so much larger than yourself. And then we get to the seventh inning and we're able to sing root, root, root for the Pirates. If they don't win, it's a shame. Well, we've had a lot of shame as Pirates fans. Yesterday was one of the worst ever. There were two outs in the ninth and we loaded the bases and gave up a hit and lost. There's a lot of shame. Maybe that's why Pittsburgh Pirate manager Chuck Tanner once said, "The secret to managing is this. The secret to managing is to have patience, is to be patient." I don't know if I have a slide with that one. The secret of managing is to be patient. The second secret of managing is to have patience. And the third most important secret is patience. Patience, patience, patience. I think that must be the secret of surviving vacation Bible school. Amen? Patience. The secret to a long relationship. Patience. The secret to parenting. Patience. The secret to career. The secret to developing deep an abiding Christian community. The secret is patience. But if people won't sing for Take Me Out to the Ball Game, some of you, I know, go to the stadium, and when it's the Star Spangled Banner, you stand and maybe mouth the words. I'm the annoying guy next to you singing the Star Spangled Banner out loud. Anybody with me? Okay, a few of you, okay? I don't see you at the stadium, though. It's usually like me by myself and people looking at me while I'm singing the Star Spangled Banner. But if you've ever been to Fenway Park, anybody? If you've ever been to Fenway, they add another song. And people who wouldn't sing anything else are willing to sing this song, Where It Began, right? And then you get to the wonderful line that was written about his wife, Marcia. Neil Diamond wrote it about his wife, Marcia, but it didn't work. He needed three syllables. And so he changed it to... And so everybody, you know, we get to Sweet Caroline. Good times never seem so good. You get the idea, and you feel like you're a part of something. Even if you're not a Red Sox fan, you feel like you're part of something larger than yourself, and you're able to sing along. That's why we teach the kids the songs with the motion, so they become more a part of them, and they can recall the motions, and it's reinforcing in their brains to help these songs and the words of Jesus to become a part of them. Our story today is from the book of Acts. And in the book of Acts, they are singing together. You might not notice it or realize it, but the people, these early Christians, have gathered together and they've been accused of some things. And after they've been accused of some things, two of the leaders, John and Peter, come back to their own. It says they come back to their people. They come back to the place they feel comfortable. They come back to the place that they belong. And when they get to that place of belonging, they recite the second psalm together. It says they're of one voice, and they recite the second psalm together. So I want us to turn to the fourth chapter of Acts as we're on the road with the Holy Spirit all summer. We're going to be walking through Acts this summer, and it begins in this way. After they were released, Peter and John, they went to their friends, their own, and reported what the chief priests and the elders had said to them. When they heard it, they raised their voices together to God and said, Sovereign Lord, let's do it together. Sovereign Lord, who made the heaven and the earth, the sea and everything in them, it is you who said by the Holy Spirit through our ancestor David, your servant, why did the Gentiles rage and the peoples imagine vain things? The kings of the earth took their stand, and the rulers have gathered together against the Lord and his Messiah. They're quoting the second psalm, and then they go on with their prayer. For in this city, in fact, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, with the Gentiles and the peoples of Israel, gathered together against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed to do whatever your hand and your plan had predestined to take place. And now, Lord, look at their threat and grant to your servants, speak your word with boldness. I love that. Speak your word with boldness. They are under threat. They have just been called into court. And rather than saying, you know, help us get out of this, they double down and they pray for boldness. Have any of you ever prayed for boldness? This is an amazing prayer in the midst of all that they're going through. They pray for boldness. While you stretch out your hand to heal and signs and wonders are performed through the name of your holy servant Jesus. When they had prayed, the place in which they gathered together was shaken. Now shake a person next to you or a chair in front of you. Just, you know, let that spirit move throughout the room. I don't see you doing it, there you go, okay. Just get shaken up a little bit. This is the second Pentecost. The Holy Spirit had come down at Pentecost, and now it's when they're praying. While they're praying, miraculous things happen in the book of Luke and the book of Acts. So when they had prayed, the place in which they were gathered together was shaken, and they were filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God with boldness. It reminds me of that trope in movies and TV where they say, permission to speak freely, sir. I don't know that in the military you get to really do that. You know, I think that, you know, in TV and things like that, it's probably frowned upon for people who have served in the military. Permission to speak freely, sir. And they say to God, permission to speak freely. Allow us to speak candidly and openly and with boldness about the good news about Jesus. Allow us to speak boldly. And when they had prayed, now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions. You know, in the United Methodist Church, we are not biblical literalists. We take the Bible very seriously, but we don't take it literally. I've been a pastor for 35 years, and I've had no one ever come to me and say, "Preacher, why don't we take this verse literally? Why don't we just take this verse literally?" The whole group of those who believe were of one heart and soul. No one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. That's pretty bold, right? And there's more. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many who as owned lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold, they laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. Now, we're going to take up a different form of offering here today. We've got some realtors. I see Michael Culver, Rachel Provo. Do we have some other realtors? If our realtors will come up front, they're willing to help you today. If you want to just bring your house keys, they'll be glad to sell your property. Because if you want to take all this literally, we can. You can come and bring your house keys, your car keys, your wallets, your purses, and just leave them here and trust that we will provide for people in need. Amen? Amen. Permission to speak freely, sir? Then there was a Levite. I don't want you to take it literally, but I do want you to take the Bible seriously. I want you to take it in such a way that you can apply it to your life. I want you to read the scripture and let it become a part of you. I want you to see the good news that can be proclaimed with boldness. Because there was one person, there was a Levite, a native of Cyprus named Joseph, to whom the apostles gave the name of Barnabas, which means son of encouragement. He sold a field that belonged to him, then brought the money and laid it at the apostles' feet. This is the good news according to the Acts of the Apostles. This is one man, because he felt a sense of belonging, because he was part of something bigger than himself, who takes what he owns and sells it and brings the money for it to be distributed and to be shared so that everyone has enough. It reminds me of covered dish dinners back in the country churches that I've served. I once served in Butts County. We lived on Big Dam Road in Butts County, and the church's name was Stark. You can't get more interesting than that. And while we were there, we had covered dish dinners, and everyone was supposed to bring something to share, but there was one woman who was infamous. She would bring her husband, her two boys, her two girls, and their friends, and she would come to the covered dish dinner with one plate of sliced tomatoes. Now, nobody ever said anything to her about it. They talked about her, but they never said anything to her about it. And the miraculous thing was, at the end of the meal, there was always more than enough, because faithful people were able to share and to be generous. And I think the question that we all have to answer in light of this text is, are we leading lives of generosity, or are we leading lives of scarcity? Are we leading lives so that others have or that others do not have? How much is enough is a question I think we have to ask ourselves as we seek to follow Christ with boldness. There was one woman who boldly prayed every morning. She would get up and she would come and stand on her front porch and she would pray, "Praise the Lord!" And she would praise the Lord for whatever was going on in her life that day. And that was just her morning practice. She would stand and proclaim it boldly on her front porch. But then a skeptic moved in next door. And that skeptic moved in. And when she would go and she would pray, "Praise the Lord," he would stand out on his porch and he'd say, "You're wasting your time. There is no Lord," and it didn't thwart her. She kept praying that prayer, praise the Lord, in thick and thin, in good times and bad. She would come out and she would pray that prayer, and it went on like that for months and years where they would go back and forth. One day, though, it was a difficult time, and she lifted up that prayer, praise the Lord. "Lord, you know it's been a tough time, and I've been hungry lately. And I've always trusted for you to provide, and I trust that you'll provide, and I continue to praise you." The next morning, she walked out onto her porch, and there were two big bags of groceries on her porch. And with the biggest smile, she said, "Praise the Lord, you've provided for me." And then her neighbor jumped out of the hedges and said, "That's not from the Lord. I went and bought you those groceries. There is no Lord." But that didn't stop her. She said, "Praise the Lord. You've provided for me groceries, Lord, and you've made the devil pay for it." We are called to a sense of boldness. We're called to a sense of boldness. And that boldness came to life in a man who got a new nickname called Barnabas, son of encouragement. Son of encouragement. And I love the word encouragement because it really means to pour courage into people. To pour courage into people who need to feel strength. To see something in people that they don't see in themselves and be willing to pour into them, to be able to pour into them strength, to be able to pour into them great grace. We all long to belong. We all want to be a part of something bigger than ourselves. And as I think this week about Barnabas, Joseph, who gave up what he had and shared it, it makes me think about belonging. Because he felt a deep sense of belonging, he gave up some of his belongings so that others would have enough. And when you belong, when you feel a part of something, you are willing to do that. And I've been contemplating and just thinking, and maybe you can help me a little bit, what is the opposite of belonging? What is the opposite of belonging? Exclusion? Isolation? Loneliness? Any others? I want to argue that the opposite of belonging is beshorting. That doesn't mean you wear shorts to work. You're beshorted when you're at work. I want to argue that the opposite of belonging is beshorting. And those are very different things and very different ways of living in the world. When you are long with other people, you are with them for the long haul. I had a member of the church tell me recently, he said, "Phil, I'm not going anywhere. I love the people of this church, and I'm not going anywhere." And that is reassuring in a day when so many people are only in it for the short run. They're only in it for the short term, for their short-term gains. To develop real deep relationships, to be able to really grow, happens in the long run, happens over the long haul. You can't instantaneously become deeper or more mature. It takes time, it takes patience, it takes a depth of relationship. Too often, though, I see people who are short with each other. Anyone been short with someone this week? Or just this morning? Just this morning, it happens. And even when I'm short with my wife, she's never short with me, but when I'm short with my wife, she's in it for the long haul, and she is able to help me to grow by sticking with me and helping me grow through my immaturity. Ladies, can I get an amen? Amen. I used to do a lot of teaching in the United Methodist Church, and I would say to young pastors, I said, instead of young pastors growing and maturing, they tend to change churches, and then they take their immaturity with them, as opposed to staying for the long haul. Friends, I have been here for 2 years today. 2 years. It feels like 10. These have been the longest 2 years of our lives, amen? I mean, they've been so long, but there have been so many rewards. There's been so much to give thanks for. And I want to assure you that I'm in this for the long haul, that I'm not going anywhere, and that I want us to grow and to mature into the church, into the kind of church that leads with the love of Christ and welcomes all in order to strengthen ourselves, our neighbors, and our neighborhoods. Is that the kind of church you want to be a part of? Is that the kind of church you are willing to dedicate yourself to for the long haul and not just the short run? I would argue that we need to be longer with one another and stop being so short-sighted, so short-tempered, so short on patience. For when you short a stock, you think that that stock is less valuable than it appears to be. But when you belong and when you are long with others, you are able to invest in them for the long term and you appreciate them. And when you appreciate something, it gains value. You're able to look at someone and see more in them than they see in themselves. I never felt like I was called to be a preacher. I went and got an MBA and a Master of Divinity, and I was going to run one of our Methodist colleges or one of our Methodist hospitals. I never saw myself as someone who was going to be a preacher, and you might say amen this morning, but I just never saw that as my calling. But I had a mentor named Fred Craddock who sort of pushed me out of the nest and encouraged me to go and to try and proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ with a level of boldness, with a level of invitation. And he tells the story of being on vacation with his wife, Nettie. They were in Oklahoma, and they were vacationing up near Gatlinburg, and they'd gone out to dinner at the Black Bear Inn. And while they were at dinner at the Black Bear Inn, this fellow walked up to them and started asking questions. And some of us really are glad to talk to other people on vacation, and some people really just want to be on vacation and not have to talk to people. Well, Craddock really would have preferred not to have had this conversation, but this fella was there at the table, and he said, "Where are you from?" And Craddock was like, "Oklahoma." He said, "What are you doing here?" As if it wasn't obvious. "Well, we're on vacation." And he said, "What do you do in Oklahoma?" And Dr. Craddock said, "I'm a minister." And he said, "What kind of minister?" And Craddock said, I'm a minister in the Christian church. It's a denomination. I'm a minister in the Christian church. And the fellow pulled up a chair and sat down with them at the table. And then he said, "I owe a great deal to a minister in the Christian church." He said, "I grew up in these mountains, and I grew up in these mountains, just my mom and me. I never knew who my daddy was, and they called me names for that. And there was a lot of shame associated with that. There was a lot of shame associated with not knowing who my daddy was. The kids at school would make fun of me. I often ate by myself. When I would go into town with my mom, you could see the people staring at me. And they would stare and they would look. And I just knew they were trying to guess and figure out who my daddy was. When I moved into my teen years, I started going to the Laurel Springs Christian Church. And when I went to the Laurel Springs Christian Church, I would go and I would sneak in just to hear the sermon. There was something about that pastor that made me want to listen. And I would go in and I would sneak in for a few minutes. And after sneaking in and listening to the sermon, I would slip out because I didn't want anybody saying something like, "What's a boy like you doing in church?" That's how I thought of myself. He said, but then one Sunday I was trying to get out, and as I was trying to get out, some people had blocked the aisle and I couldn't escape. And before I could get out the back door, I felt a heavy hand on my shoulder. And when I felt that heavy hand on my shoulder, I knew it had to be the minister. And I slowly turned around and he looked down at me and he said, "I know who you are. I know whose boy you are." And he said, "I knew my goose was cooked." I knew that he was going to say it there, and I'd never be able to go back to that church. I'd never be able to set foot in there again. And the minister stared at me a long time, and he said, "I know who you are. I know who you are. I can see it. You are a child of God. I can see the family resemblance." He said, "My life changed that day." He said, "In fact, that day was the beginning of my life. For someone saw in me something I hadn't even yet seen in myself." You never know the act of caring for a child in Vacation Bible School. You never know the impact that that might have. I can't believe that my Vacation Bible School leader could ever, in their wildest dreams, believe that I would be standing in front of a church. I can't believe that they would. Brené Brown says there are four things that bring people into belonging, that bring a true sense of connection. And I'd like to walk through those with you for a moment. There are four things that bring a sense of belonging. People are hard to hate close up, so move in. Can I get an amen? That is what the early church did. That's what the early church did. They moved in. They moved out of their comfort zone, and with boldness they went and proclaimed the good news from Jerusalem to Judea to Samaria to the ends of the earth. They didn't stay at a distance in hate. They moved up close and loved. The second is they speak truth to lies. Now, she uses a different word that I can't use in church, but it starts with a B and ends with an S. Speak truth to lies. Be civil. And too often, we've lost our civility here in this country, our civility that used to be part of who we are. And so they spoke truth to lies with boldness and were civil to one another. This next one is something we do in church. It makes you uncomfortable. We hold hands with strangers, but that binds us together in ways that we don't even fully understand. And sometimes we hold hands and sing, and the love of and the peace of Christ flows through us. And finally, have a strong back, a soft front, and a wild heart. A wild heart. I think those are beautiful ways to build deep connection. We sought to build deep connection with the kids during vacation Bible school. Pastor Garrett got welcomed, and these kids needed no encouragement. The fourth and fifth graders made their way into his office and gave him a tremendous welcome with post-it notes. I think we have a picture of what they did to his office to make him feel welcome. And then Pastor Garrett was in charge of it one day, and they did it to my office. They needed no encouragement. Have you been short with anyone lately? What would it mean for you to be in it for the long haul? What would it mean for you to belong with someone who needs to hear some encouragement? Dr. Craddock said to that man who told the story about the Christian church, He said, "Sir, what is your name?" And the fellow said, "My name is Ben Hooper." And Craddock remembered who Ben Hooper was. Ben Hooper was the two-term governor of Tennessee, who was known as the first illegitimate son to be a two-term governor of Tennessee. You never know what can happen in people's lives if you'll be able to see Christ in them. If you'll be able to look at them with love and encouragement and hope. We lost a pillar of the community here this week. A woman named Florence Fortenberry. Her son Steve teaches at Dunwoody High School. And Florence has been a member of this church since 1967. She was in it for the long haul. And she was the kind of person that didn't just encourage you, but she would push you and say, "I see things in you that you don't see in yourself." And she would push you to something more. And I give thanks for people like Florence Fortenberry who were in it for the long haul and who were able to push us into something more and to call us something into something more. I just have to believe that Florence Fortenberry is staring down from heaven today and looking at Bible school and saying to herself, "It's so good. It's so good. It's so good." May we seek to be sons of encouragement, daughters of encouragement, who build others up because we're with them and they're with us for the long haul. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we give you thanks for the privilege of being able to host Bible school this week. We hope that the children saw the face of Christ in the leaders and as they learned your stories and your songs. Help us, O God, not to just go through the motions, but to seek to invest in others who need to hear your love and grace. In your blessed name we pray. Amen.
Monkey, do you want to be long with this church? I'm learning something from Phil, y'all. Be long. Belong. Be long. I think it's beautiful. This is a place where we can all be long. And that's something we can praise God for. And your belonging and your willingness to be long, it shows up in your prayers, in your presence, in your gifts, in your service, in your witness. This church would not be this church if we weren't being long. During our offertory, you're going to see videos and pictures from what it means to be long. We hope that you take this moving forward and know that you are a child of God, that you belong, and that your belonging gives someone else their sense of belonging. Right, Monkey? May God bless us as we step into our belonging and we give.
You cut me down a tree and brought it back to me. And that's what made me see where I was going wrong. You put me on a shelf and kept me for yourself. I can only blame myself. You can only blame me. And I could write a song 100 miles long. Well, that's where I belong, and you belong with me. And I could write it down or spread it all around, get lost and then get found, or swallowed in the sea. You put me on a line and hung me out to dry. Darling, that's when I decided to go see you. You cut me down to size and opened up my eyes. Made me realize that I could not see. And I could write a book.
The middle of the word belonging is long, as we all long to be a part of something larger than ourselves. And the great thing about being part of a community is when we don't know the words, or we don't know the motions, or we don't even feel like singing that day, there are other people that will carry the song and carry the tune until we're ready to sing again. That is the gift of being long with each other. May you go forth into God's mercy and God's grace and have a week that is so good, so good, so good. Amen.
Won't you stand and join us? Oh.
Good, very good, very good. You know, being long with people means you give second chances, doesn't it? Isn't that what being long with people? It means everybody gets a mulligan or two. Jenny Rolfes is one of our hospitality people, and she'll be out there to greet you. If you're visiting with the church and would like to have any more information, she'll be glad to visit with you as you leave today. I hope you'll stand, and if you're willing, take the hand of one near you. It's COVID. I know you might not want to, but that's how we grow. Be careful. But stand, take the hand of one near you as we sing our benediction song.
Holy Ghost, hold us together, bless us and keep us, and grant us peace. Wonderful Father, come shine upon us, show us favor and teach us love. Until we return, let us live peace. Us and keep us and grant us peace. Wonderful Father, come shine upon us, show us favor in Jesus' name.
Amen. Go in peace. Have a great week.